In this segment of the endocrine system, we are going to be focusing on the posterior pituitary and the hormones that are associated with that gland. And so this segment is going to be focusing on two different hormones that are associated with the posterior pituitary, and those two hormones are going to be ADH, which is also called vasopressin, and oxytocin. Both of these hormones are associated with the posterior pituitary. Throughout the next series of lectures, we're going to be discussing various endocrine organs and what hormones that they synthesize and secrete. So it's very important as we go through each of these segments that you understand for each of the endocrine organs, what hormone is synthesized and secreted? Is there a specific location from which these hormones are released? And then if there's a feedback loop associated with it, you need to know that feedback loop and understand how that feedback loop functions. You have to understand the function for each of the hormones and also for abnormalities. So if you hypo or hyper secrete these hormones, what would be the outcome? So to begin, we're just going to take a moment to describe primary versus secondary endocrine organs. These segments on the endocrine system will focus on the primary endocrine organs. Primary endocrine organs, their major function, or their primary function, in other words, is to synthesize and secrete hormones. We also have what are called secondary endocrine organs. Secondary endocrine organs have other primary functions, but secondarily they do produce or synthesize and secrete hormones. In the segments on the endocrine system, we are going to focus on the primary endocrine organs. Later, when we get to the cardiovascular system, we'll discuss hormones that are secreted in the heart. And once we get to regulation of gastrointestinal system, we will discuss various hormones that are associated with the gastrointestinal system, such as the stomach and the liver, as well as the small intestine. So once again, the focus for the endocrine system is to focus on the primary endocrine organs. So let's go ahead and focus on the hormones of the posterior pituitary. Now, these hormones that are located in the posterior pituitary are stored in the posterior pituitary. That is very important to understand. The posterior pituitary does not synthesize and secrete hormones. The posterior pituitary only stores hormones. So let's take a close look at each of these hormones that are associated with the posterior pituitary. The first of these is called antidiuretic hormone, ADH, which is also known as vasopressin. Vasopressin, or ADH, is produced primarily by the paraventricular nuclei of the hypothalamus. The paraventricular nuclei of the hypothalamus are part of a neurosecretory neuron that is located in the hypothalamus. And hence, when we say paraventricular nuclei, this is the nucleus that's found within that neurosecretory cell. So ADH targets the kidneys, and when it targets the kidneys, its function is to help with osmolarity, or to help maintain water balance within the body. Now, oxytocin is a hormone that's produced primarily by the supraoptic nucleus of the hypothalamus. Once again, it's important to note that the supraoptic nuclei are part of a neurosecretory neuron that's located in the hypothalamus. So once again, now we have antidiuretic hormone and oxytocin. They're both synthesized and secreted by neurosecretory neurons in the hypothalamus, and they are stored in the posterior pituitary. Now, in terms of oxytocin's target and function, so it targets a couple of different tissues within the human body, that is the uterus, as well as the breasts or the mammary glands. When oxytocin targets the uterus or binds to receptors on the uterus, that will cause uterine contraction that will result in birth of a child. When oxytocin binds to cells of the mammary glands, that causes milk to be expelled from those glands. So this is very important for breastfeeding. Now, oxytocin is also involved in the mother-child bonding. And so when you think about at birth, when a mother is introduced to her child for the very first time, that mother is bonded to that child. And one of the reasons researchers believe that is so is because of the high level of oxytocin, and that's what causes that mother-child bond that occurs when that child is born. Now, there are a lot of other studies being done on oxytocin, and there's a lot of exciting things being done. So, as you progress through your career in the health sciences, then you may come across some of those new discoveries. So, in all, with ADH and oxytocin, these are both functionally classified as neurohormones. So, hopefully you're asking yourself, why? Why are they classified as neurohormones? They're classified as neurohormones because of the neurosecretory neuron that synthesizes and secretes them. And remember, that neurosecretory neuron is located in the hypothalamus. Chemically, both of these hormones are classified as peptides. So let's focus a little more detail on antidiuretic hormone. So this is a hormone that is often confusing to students based on the name. So we're going to back up and think first off about what a diuretic causes you to do. So if you are an iced tea drinker, you're a coffee drinker, then you will know that those two drinks are diuretics. So what do? They cause you to urinate. So if it's an antidiuretic, think about what the prefix anti means. So you're doing the opposite. So antidiuretic means you will urinate less or have decreased urination. So the function of antidiuretic hormone then is to decrease urination so that you urinate less. And the reason I go through this is because this is sort of a backwards way of thinking when it comes to antidiuretic hormone. So let's look at what stimulates antidiuretic hormone release or vasopressin release. Extreme pain, having a low blood pressure, as well as stress. These are at least three items that can stimulate antidiuretic hormone release, as well as nicotine, if you're a smoker, or morphine. Okay, so a lot of times we'll have patients that are on morphine or a morphine equivalent like Dilaudid, which all stimulate ADH release, antidiuretic hormone. So let's take a look at this diagram and try to interpret what this diagram means. So at the top of this diagram, I have a low concentration of ADH. If I have very little antidiuretic hormone, you will urinate a lot. Now that is opposite to if you have high ADH, as illustrated by the bottom of this triangle. So if you have high ADH, you will have decreased urination. So let's think about a condition where you may have a patient, for example, or even a friend of yours that has ADH, however, it's hyposecreted. So first off, think about what hypo means. Hypo means less. So we're secreting little ADH. So if you don't secrete a lot of ADH, you have low ADH, you're going to urinate a lot. You will increase your urination. Now, this is a condition called diabetes insipidus. Do not confuse diabetes insipidus with diabetes mellitus. Diabetes insipidus is based on ADH, not blood sugar levels. They are completely different. Now, one of the symptoms, if you have diabetes insipidus, is that you're thirsty a lot because you're urinating so much. And so if you're not replenishing the fluids that you lose, you tend to become dehydrated. And as a result of dehydration, you can have headaches. So the treatment for this is fairly simple. You drink a lot of water. You need to drink water in order to replenish the fluids you've lost because of your increased urination. So now let's think about what could inhibit ADH release. So we've already talked about a condition where you have diabetes insipidus, where you hyposecrete ADH. But let's think about alcohol and drinking alcohol. So you could think about this in terms of going off to happy hour, perhaps. And when you go to happy hour, how frequently you visit the restroom. So if you inhibit your ADH release by drinking alcohol, you are going to increase your urination. So often then explains why you go to the bathroom more frequently. And it also explains why you end up with dry mouth because you're thirsty, headaches because you can be dehydrated because you're not drinking enough water, and hence you have a hangover. So general rule of thumb, to avoid hangovers because of this ADH, for every beer that you drink or every alcoholic drink that you consume, drink one glass of water with it, and that will help counter the effects of ADH.